Hello, and thanks for tuning in to Kalkine TV. Here is another edition of Executive Corner Expert Talks. Today, we're narrowing in on Muddy Machines, the pioneer ag tech company that's developing robots to drive the industry towards zero emissions and help farmers grow produce. And joining us today to share their insights is founder and CEO Florian Richter. Welcome to the show, Florian. It's great to have you with us.
Pleasure to be here, Holly. Thanks for having me.
Pleasure to have you on the show. Now, first and foremost, what would you say is the core objective of Muddy Machines?
Yeah, that's a very good question that all founders should ask themselves, right? So my co-founder and CTO, Chris and I, we said we want to actually, with this company, forge a path for agriculture to, you know, really become beneficial to both people and planet. And we firmly believe that agriculture is probably one of the very few industries that can not only be net zero, but actually contribute towards reversing climate change. And, you know, the solutions, they exist. We know what we need to do. It's just that one thing that we believe is stopping wide adoption is labor supply, right? These practices are very costly because they are labor intensive. I mean, there are others. And our mission, our vision here is to sustainably solve agriculture's labor challenges with our core skill, which is building robots.
That's interesting. What sort of labor challenges have you come up against and seen in recent years? Obviously, there must have been a big shift post-COVID for you there, but what are we seeing now in the industry?
So COVID certainly brought labor shortage kind of to a point where it's no longer bearable for farmers, and they are considering one by one to exit crops that are particularly labor intensive. Labor shortages, increasing labor costs or labor cost inflation has been a thing for decades, I'd say. The traditional population of seasonal workers are slowly aging out of the labor force. And I mean, to be fair to the younger generations, there are other things you can do with your by the hour than going into a very warm field, very hot field, dusty or rainy, anything's coming at you and picking crop, right? And so with COVID, that we then went from a slowly going situation that was getting worse and worse to something that within one season became 30%, 50% labor shortages, crops rotting in the field and growers losing tens of millions of pounds. And we thought, okay, this is probably a thing here in the UK, Brexit, COVID, perfect storm. But the more we spoke to growers abroad in other countries, I mean, not only first world countries, everywhere we heard the same story, different reasons. I mean, there are immigration policies, there are economic shifts in the kind of labor source countries, but I've yet to meet a horticulture farmer that hasn't complained about labor shortages or labor costs.
Right, I don't doubt that for 1 minute. I think you're absolutely hitting the nail on the head there. It is a widespread issue, and it has only drastically worsened from the sounds of it in years, so that is quite unfortunate. And now, you did mention earlier that you're sort of in the business of meeting the needs of both people and earth with Muddy Machines. So I'd love to know, in your opinion, how is autonomous agricultural technology or ag tech paving the way towards a more sustainable sector?
So I think from a sustainability point of view, you can look at many angles, right? So maybe let's start with the society. Increasingly are more conscious of what we eat, what is the composition of the food we are eating. And with vegetables, it's a very straightforward business because the fresher, the better, right? And so the best food I believe you can eat is seasonal vegetables that are grown very close to where you are. I don't think it needs to be necessarily in a vertical farm next door. It can be in a field within a short drives away. Those supply chains exist. But when we're talking then out of season produce, of course, we cannot grow this domestically. There are big costs in terms of CO2 emissions for running greenhouses. So maybe importing them is the best chance. But while there is a season for a certain type of crop in your country, I think we should try everything we can to grow it here, wherever here is, right? Northern hemisphere, southern hemisphere. But the situation that we're facing is that we are losing the capacity to grow these crops because, again, of the labor shortages. And so that's what we want to battle and say to growers, here's a planable, scalable, and reliable source of labor. You can continue to invest in these crops. We can continue to keep the food miles short while these vegetables are in season. We can potentially even help with improving the unit economics for growing these crops by driving yield up, because we can be more granular in terms of the data we collect and understanding how is not only the performance field by field, but even square meter by square meter, or crop by crop, plant by plant. These are all things that are completely unthinkable to do with humans. You're happy enough when they harvest your crop accurately, but asking them after the ship, okay, so what was the average length of the spear or average weight of each thing that you harvested? And no one will do that, right? And with a robot, this is, you just read out the logs and visualize that to the farmer. So we hope that there are lots of opportunities then moving on from society benefit to industry benefit to remove this labor bottleneck and actually give a solution that opens up new opportunities that then, yeah, results in a better profitability, results in a decreased need to use pesticides or herbicides, allows potentially to target the use of herbicides a bit better. But ultimately, we hope for a place where a robot can do more than just harvesting, right? We can also help with keeping the weed pressure down in a mechanical way. The first thing you need to do is establish this platform that is operating like, I mean, you probably know the Roomba vacuum cleaners, right? They're not very quick, right? But they do the job eventually in your house. And that's kind of the opportunity we see for robotics in horticulture. Every plant needs to be looked at every day to see, has it produced a bit of crop that is harvestable at that moment? Currently, you make this trade-off. Do I send the team of harvesters in today? Do I not? It's kind of a cost in this field that I incur or not. And with a robot that goes through the field, or a team of robots that goes through the field, you can always get the crop at the optimal time. And again, thinking of sustainability for the planet, what are the parameters that we need to work in? We believe that this mustn't be a solution that relies on fossil fuels. So it should be a battery-powered electrical solutions. I know that there are lots of questions yet to be answered on what materials do we use for batteries, what's the weight, power composition, etc. But we think that there are solutions in the pipeline for that. That means that the machine has to be lightweight, because big, heavy machinery and battery power doesn't go very well together. And the other thing is that for the grower, probably the most important aspect is soil compaction from heavy machinery is a really big issue. You have this issue already in broadacre farms and arable, where you have very few passes every year. But in horticulture, where you're potentially looking at a pass every day, we don't believe you can build a big combine that has great pick volumes and pick speed, but rather make use of this time like, okay, we have 24 hours to do this. If one machine only replaces a handful of people, this is probably okay. Think about robots replacing people is unemployment. And are we making anyone unemployed? I really don't think that is the case. We are talking about a labor shortage. It will take years until we get to a point where a farmer will actually begin to say, I'd rather not hire people and put robots instead. And our hope is actually that we are contributing to upskilling the type of work that is done on farms. You know, that it is more, again, more sustainable, highly paid per hour, right? As opposed to picking crop or looking after, being a team leader, looking after people, looking after robots, right? Maybe this can bring a new generation of people into the rural areas, because the work is becoming more of a career opportunity.
Absolutely. Great to see. And it's interesting as well that you did bring up that employment aspect there. I think a lot of people are worried about redundancies from the rise of machinery taking over there. But you're absolutely right. It could be a very viable option for upscaling rather than making a bunch of potential farmers unemployed, for example. So very much on the money there. And you do have one machine in the works that we know of, which is Sprout. And yeah. I have seen it myself. It's very interesting looking, and I'd love to know a bit more about how it functions. And your green asparagus harvesting robot, which is Sprout, obviously.
Yes, I think for our technology, you need to think in two or maybe even three categories, right? One is the machine that carries the tool, that drives around, that needs to overcome the field environment, that needs to be resistant to the elements, etc., where all the computing power, the battery, etc., sits. The third bit is the software that actually understands what it's supposed to be doing. And the other bit is the end effector, right? What is the tool that actually interacts with the crop, the specific camera for that crop? And so this, imagine this tool, that's what we call the harvester, that slots into Sprout. So Sprout is for, if you want to say a tool carrier. And asparagus, green asparagus harvester, that's the first tool we have developed. I can show you a little video here of what it looked like last year. We have developed a new version for this year, but this was the very, very first prototype of our end effectors, or Sprout's arm, so to say. You can see it rotates around, avoiding spears that are not yet mature. It's important that it picks off very close to the ground so that there's no additional photosynthesis happening, so that more spears are being driven up. And yeah, so we have developed a Sprout tool that can actually operate with two arms, so therefore dramatically increasing pick speed. And we're currently trialing this in the field. What does Sprout look like? So this is the design drawing that we came up with after our field tests last year. We are almost done building it, and this is what Sprout looks like now. Still missing a bit of a paint job in the hood. This machine should be ready to be demoed at the Asparagus Growers Conference here in the UK in early July. And then we will see how many people can it replace, what kind of fields does it do very well in. It's a very interesting problem, asparagus, for sure. And we started in asparagus because, I mean, you've seen it in the picker video, right? There's very low weed pressure in conventional systems, so you have a very good vision angle, you have near no foliage coverage, and the spears, judging the pick, the readiness of a spear is basically measuring the length. So the complexity that you have in some fruit or tomato or berries, where you really need to look at the color, other characteristics, you don't have to be quite as detailed in your vision analysis there. So this really helped and allowed us to go from concept to prototype within 6 months. So we're really moving very fast. Sprout is pretty amazing. It can go up 20% inclines. It can deal with any kind of field environment that you can throw at it. Interestingly, the fields are all right. The tricky thing is getting into the field sometimes because of water runoff and access roads. But Sprout is really ready now to do more than asparagus.
I could imagine. I mean, it's very impressive, I must say, just hearing all of that. And it's great to hear as well that it is able to handle that tough terrain, I think, that a lot of agricultural areas see. But all around, great to hear. You are moving very fast. We'll definitely keep an eye on your upcoming trial. I think, was it July you mentioned?
Yes, that's when we will probably, draw the curtain and show where we've got to this season. We will be focusing mainly on the UK for next year. So we've got a very strong partnership with probably the largest asparagus grower over here. He's Cobury Farms. They are supporting us with, plenty of crop to test on, with a test site, with a shed to house our robots. And it's been a very, very good partnership. This is the key thing. If you want to change anything in agriculture, you need to be working very closely with the growers. Otherwise, you're operating in a vacuum.
Right, right. Well, I take your word for it there. But it's very exciting stuff overall, what you're doing. And we'll definitely keep an eye out for everything Money Machines has going on in the upcoming year and beyond. But with that said, thanks very much for making time for us today, Florian. It's been great to have you on Executive Corner Expert Talks.
Yes, my pleasure. Thank you.
Pleasure to have you on. Viewers as well, if you've just joined us, that was Florian Richter, the founder and CEO of Money Machines. And if you missed any part of that chat, you can catch the full interview on our YouTube channel at Kalkine Media, and make sure to subscribe. I'm Holly Shields, reminding you to stay apprised and invest wise with Kalkine.